Hello, everyone. Welcome to the CSE Robotics Colloquium. We meet every Friday at 1:30 on Seattle time. It's a beautiful, bright, sunny day today, which happens all the time in Seattle. So today, it's a great pleasure for me to introduce Sanjiban Choudhury, Professor Sanjiban Choudhury. Sanjiban got his PhD at Carnegie Mellon University. That's when I first met him. He had some really interesting ideas in motion planning, which is my sort of favorite topic. And we sort of started meeting ad hoc and then decided that we would actually work together. So I worked with Sanjiban throughout his PhD thesis. His PhD supervisor was Sebastian Scherer. Sanjiban did some really remarkable work in motion planning, learning heuristics, imitation learning, and then did a postdoc with me at Carnegie Mellon and then at the University of Washington, and then joined Aurora as a research scientist, where he runs a lot of their motion planning programs. And will be starting as an assistant professor at Cornell University in computer science, July 2022. So I think what I really enjoyed about Sanjiban's work is that it's works backwards really from real problems for real robots. Sanjiban's definitely a very full stack roboticist, but also tries to unearth the fundamental technical questions that are important for it. I've really enjoyed proving theorems with Sanjiban, writing algorithms with Sanjiban, hacking robots with Sanjiban, and also incredibly high quality work that inspires me to be better at what I'm doing. So without further ado, Sanjiban.
Thank you, Sid, for the much too kind introduction. Hi, everyone. I'm Sanjiban Choudhury. As Sid mentioned, I'm currently a research scientist at Aurora, where we work on self-driving. And I'll be joining Cornell as assistant professor this fall. Today, I'm really excited to talk about interactive imitation learning. How do we build robots that learn from human interaction and plan alongside human partners? And in the spirit of this talk, I would love this to be interactive. So if you have questions, feel free to jump right in. So the question at the core of my research is, how do we design robots that both understand and learn from natural human interactions? You know, for those of you who've seen this movie Baymax, this will be a familiar scene where Hero teaches Baymax to do a fist bump. And what's beautiful about this scene is that Hero, through a simple sequence of interactions, it's able to communicate this novel concept of a fist bump to Baymax. So how do we build such robots that continually improve and learn online to adapt to individual human preferences? Now, to do so, we need to tackle two fundamental challenges. First, how should robots learn from natural human interactions? So consider grandma receiving a brand new robot apprentice. There are a number of tasks she wants the apprentice to do in a specific way, but that's latent in her mind. So how can the robot interact with her to infer these latent preferences from natural modes of feedback like gestures, interventions, and corrections? Second, how should robots plan to accomplish these tasks alongside human partners? So the robot must be able to anticipate how humans move, understand their intent, and move in a safe, predictable manner around humans. Now, for the past 2.5 years, I've been working in self-driving at Aurora with an amazing team led by Drew Bagnell. Our product is the Aurora Driver. This is a general suite of software and hardware designed to work on any vehicle from passenger sedans to Class 8 trucks. Now, you may be wondering, what does this hunk of steel have to do with humans? The answer is a lot. Let me show you. So this is a hyperlapse of the Aurora driver hauling goods without any human intervention. It's fascinating to see this robot drive like a human and alongside humans in the real world, engaging in, you know, novel interactions like merges, lane changes, stop signs, unprotected left turns, and much more. And this is not a one-off result. Our product is hauling goods every single day. And it's pretty cool to think that in just 9 months, we went from never running on a truck to this result. That's fine, but what is the science behind this result? That's what we'll talk about today. So let's look at any one particular snapshot and ask a question. What is the optimal action a robot can take given the scene? Now you might think, why not take every rule in the official driving handbook and just apply that? Well, that would not be very useful because most of the rules of driving aren't explicit, but rather implicit. So, you know, this orchestrated chaos that you see is what we call traffic back home. It's absolutely unclear to me if I can engineer a set of rules to get a robot to repeat this feat. So explicitly programming rules is tedious. For instance, in self-driving, the right rule depends very much on what other humans are doing. But interestingly, we humans are able to seamlessly drive every single day. So how can we implicitly program robots by having them imitate human driving? That's one of the key pieces. Secondly, robots are not alone in the road, right? Take a look at this busy, unprotected left, full of pedestrians and cars. You know, if the robot simply viewed these actors as dynamic obstacles, it'll never make this turn. It has to actively create an opening by predicting how other actors will respond to its actions. So to do this, the robot has to understand the latent intents of other human actors and communicate its own intent to plan a safe path to the goal. Now, to make things a little bit more concrete, let's ground these problems in a familiar framework of a Markov decision process. So recall that an MDP is a tuple of state, action, cost, and transition. I'm using cost here because, you know, I come from an optimal control background. So the state here is the position, velocity, and acceleration of a robot, as well as other humans. Now, the cost function for this MDP is actually latent and in the mind of the human drivers. So we need to use imitation learning to recover this cost function or directly the value function. Also, the transition function is unknown because it depends on the state of other humans, how their state evolves based on actions the robot takes. So we also need to learn this function by predicting the latent human intent. So with that, let's return to our original picture. Today, we'll talk about two challenges. First, we'll talk about imitation learning. How do we interact with the human to learn the optimal policy? Second, we'll talk about intent prediction. How do we interactively forecast human actions conditioned on actions the robot takes? All right, so let's begin with this first challenge of imitation learning. So I'll begin with a rather simple problem that is motivated by real-world events at Aurora. So let's say you wanted to learn when to do a lane change. Here we have a truck, and on the right we have a slot between two cars. You know, we can typically think of this problem from the lens of machine learning. So we want to extract some features from the scene and predict a final action. Should we lane change or not? So think of this as a straight up binary classification problem, right? Should be super easy. What are features for a lane change? Well, one feature could be, you know, how far away is the exit? Another feature could be, is there a disabled vehicle on the shoulder? A third feature could be, is the traffic congestion level too high, right? Now, one day your intern comes in, one of your interns come in and adds a feature that stores the past action. That is whether you decided to lane change or not in the previous time step. Okay. Now, a standard approach to imitation learning is behavior cloning, which basically treats this as a vanilla supervised learning problem. So there's basically three simple steps. Step one, go collect lots of data of humans doing lane changes. So we'll refer to the humans as an expert here because think of the humans as expert Aurora drivers. And in 50% of the data, we see the humans don't lane change because there's a car occupying the lane on the right. And in 50% of the other cases, we see that they lane change and the car on the right slows down. Okay, so you go collect this data. Step two, train a classifier that maps features to actions. And step three, validate the policy on some held out data. And if this looks good, deploy. Now, you get an exciting Slack message from your intern. Wow, my classifier has 99% accuracy. And before you said overfitting, I added regularization, I verified validation set, everything's looking good. You're stunned, your intern is overjoyed, and your team goes for beers. Next day, you test this model on the road with bated breath. 99% should mean pretty perfect response, right? So let's say the truck makes, let's say we have a scene where the truck is driving and there's a car on the right lane. And let's say it makes a rare mistake and starts lane changing, even though the car on the right is moving pretty fast. But that's okay, you know, 99% means the classifier can make a mistake 1% of the time, no big deal. But something strange happens in the next time step. Even as the car moves faster, instead of aborting the lane change, the truck doubles down. It just keeps going. And the robot continues making mistakes, almost running the car off the road. What happened? Why didn't the robot just abort the lane change? Well, if you take a look at the training data, you see that what the robot has ended up learning is a very strong correlation between the previous action and the current action. This explains the 99% accuracy metric. I mean, it's not surprising at all. Humans drive smoothly. Of course, consecutive actions are correlated across time. For example, if you were going, you will continue going. If you were not going, you'll continue not going, other than the rare transition points from not lane changing to lane changing. But at test time, the robot just happens to make one mistake at the beginning. But once it begins going, it latches onto that mistake and continues going. In other words, we have a bad feedback loop. This feedback forces the robot to go into states it has not seen at train time. And since there are no labels for the state, the robot does not know how to recover and it makes more mistakes. And as a result, feedback drives a covariate shift between training and test distribution, leading to a performance gap of O epsilon T square. That is, it grows quadratically in time. So feedback drives covariate shift. This is the core challenge that differentiates imitation learning from supervised learning. Feedback breaks a core assumption in machine learning that data is IID. In fact, the distribution of inputs or states depend on the very policy we are learning. In case you're wondering, wait, how common is this problem? Let me assure you, it is very common. These are four papers from self-driving over the last few years that talk about this very issue. And it's not just the self-driving industry. So back in my postdoc days at UW in 2018, we built a whole fleet of self-driving cars called Musher, which we were trying to program via imitation learning. So on the top right is Jonathan, who was driving around the cars providing demonstrations. On the bottom, you see a visualization of the learned policy where blue are, let's say, good actions and red are bad. So the policy looks pretty reasonable, right? Well, when we roll the learner out, it starts to drive well and then crashes into a wall. It's the same underlying issue. So once the robot makes a mistake, it enters a state it hasn't seen before and continues making mistakes. Okay, so it would appear that there is a mountain of evidence for feedback driving covariate shift. So we thought, okay, we should probably be able to reproduce this in standard benchmarks as well, right? Turns out we were totally wrong. So the first thing we did is we took benchmarks from imitation learning papers, simply ran behavior cloning for long enough to drive down optimization errors, and the learned policy performance was pretty close to the expert. Okay, so we thought, maybe these environments are a bit too easy. Let's look at more complex environments. Turns out literature has time and time again shown that behavior cloning does pretty well, right? In fact, there's a recent paper by Florence et al. That shows behavior cloning on D4RL is pretty comparable to most alternatives. This is puzzling. I just showed you that feedback is a real problem in self-driving. I mean, us and our competitors have all reported on it, but on standard datasets, behavior cloning is just fine. Is it to do with the data or to do with the policy class or the domain or something else? So in times like this, we need clarity. So let's take a quick journey to the infinite data limit. I'll show you that covariate shift isn't just one thing. There are actually three regimes of covariate shift. Some are easy, some are hard, and some are just right. Let's begin with the easy setting. So here, the human expert is realizable. What does that mean? That means with infinite data, you can make the error zero. So for example, let's take our race car and put it on a track. You have a human expert that drives perfectly down the center of the track, right? So shown the figure on the left shows the state distribution, for example. Your learner, given infinite data, can drive regression loss precisely to zero to exactly match the expert. So if you're in this regime, the solution is really simple. Go collect lots and lots of data and do behavior cloning. We conjecture that this might be the regime in which many of the benchmarks fall, because either the expert is also a two-layer MLP that the policy representation is, or the network that we're using is just expressive enough. Okay. Now, what if the expert is non-realizable and does not visit all states? For instance, let's say our learner can't perfectly drive down the center of a track and spins out of the track. But the expert never leaves the track, so we don't really know how to recover. This is an example that I stole from my collaborator, Gokul. You know, think of the expert as Roadrunner and the learner as Wile E. Coyote. And if the expert never fell off a cliff, how will the learner know how to get back on? And this is precisely the flavor of problems we saw before. The human was simply not realizable and didn't visit all the states. And this setting is what we term as the hard setting. So in a seminal paper, Ross and Bagnell showed that in such settings, behavior cloning compounds in error. So you get O epsilon T squared. Recently, our work with Gokul Swami generalized this result to show that the entire class of off-policy methods, you know, you could use any favorite off-policy method you'd like. There's many in literature. All of them compound in error with O epsilon T squared. So this is the best you can do if all you had is some off-policy demonstrations. Okay, when does this hard setting occur? So one signature that we discovered is when the following happens. This is when the expert has access to more privileged information than the learner. So this is true in a number of settings. For example, we just talked about self-driving, where oftentimes a human has more context than perception can infer. Maybe they're looking at a scene and are able to tell when a driver is signaling them to go. This is also true when you're not imitating humans, but rather oracles that have access to more information at train time. For example, an optimal planner that knows the full model at train time. So I had a string of papers in my PhD that analyzed this problem and looked at the consequences of such an information gap. And finally, there's a recent paper from DeepMind that shows language sequence models like chatbots also fall into this category, where the actions of the chatbot feeds back in loops of self-delusion. Okay, so the hard setting is a very real, inescapable setting. So let's go back to our picture. The hard setting is one where we have a non-realizable expert and limited support. Behavior cloning or any off-policy algorithms compound in error. So what can we do if we find ourselves in this setting? Fortunately, there's a solution. Simply interactively query the expert on states you will visit. So in a seminal paper, Ross et al. Presented a really simple meta algorithm called Dagger, which may be familiar to many, which iterates over three basic steps. Step one, take your current learner and roll it out. Step two, query the expert to get the correct labels on the states the learner visits. Step three, and important, aggregate this data and train a new learner on the full data. If you do this, you can prove that you generate a sequence of policies such that at least one policy in that sequence is pretty good. That is, it achieves O epsilon T error. In fact, we showed in our work that Dagger is just one algorithm in an entire class of interactive expert algorithms. For example, Aggravate is another algorithm. And this entire class of approaches achieves O epsilon T performance bound. Okay. So this suggests that as long as we can interactively query the expert, we should be good in this hard setting. But ask yourself, is this really a practical algorithm to ask the human over and over for labels for every situation the robot visits? I mean, think about when you learn driving. Did you do all sorts of crazy things like entering the wrong side of the highway and asking your instructor for corrections? No, right? So this is not only a lot of effort for the human, it may actually be unsafe. How can we learn from more natural human interactions, say interventions? So let's look at how interventions work. We conjecture that humans have a mental model of a subspace of states that's good enough. So as long as the robot is in this state, the human does not feel the need to correct. As the robot is about to leave the subspace, the human intervenes. Takes over control, drives the robot back into a good enough region and gives back control. So how do we turn this interaction into an algorithm? We had a very simple insight. Interventions tell us something about the human's latent value function. So the way the story goes is that the human presumably has this latent value function that captures cumulative cost of taking actions and acting optimally thereafter. So every piece of intervention gives us a teeny glimpse of this latent action value. Even non-interventions tell us something about the action value. Our approach, expert intervention learning or EIL, exploits this insight. So we model these interventions as constraints on the latent action value function. We formalize this as follows. So we are solving for an action value function Q that maps state actions to real values. So the lower the value, the better. Given a set of expert demonstrations, S star and A star, sample from P of expert, the objective is to correctly classify these demonstrations. That is, your A star must belong to the minima of Q. Next, as the robot executes its policy, we are going to end up with three types of constraints on Q. At stage one, when the human is not intervening, we can definitively say that all the Q values are below some threshold delta. At stage two, the human takes over because something bad happened. Then we can at least say that the Q values are above that threshold. Finally, at stage three, as the human drives the robot back, we can say the intervention actions are locally optimal. And putting all of this together, we end up with a streaming constraint optimization problem that we can reduce to an online convex optimization that we can solve efficiently. And that results in an O epsilon T error as well, which is what we got out of Dagger. So how does EIL perform on the robot? So in this video, you can see Jonathan intervenes as soon as the robot gets close to the wall and then returns back control when it's in a good enough state. So in the early trial, EIL fails just like behavior cloning because of the compounding of errors. But as it gets more and more interventions, it starts to get better and better. And after about 60 seconds of trials, EIL runs without Jonathan intervening at all, which is pretty cool. And on the same problem, I think behavior cloning continued to fail even after 24 demonstrations. A quick look at the quantitative plots. I guess what the plots are trying to say is that EIL is able to drive down errors with much less queries. So we see behavior cloning shown in yellow, sort of plateaus. Dagger wastes a lot of repeated expert query in good states. And the closest baseline was HG Dagger, which is a lot like EIL, but it only uses the explicit feedback from interventions. And we show here both empirically and in theory that this throws away a lot of useful information that EIL leverages. Okay, so in the hard setting, we are able to get around this non-realizable expert, but we relied on an interactive expert that we could query on policy. But the question is there a Goldilocks setting in the middle? So what if you have a non-realizable expert, but one that has full support? So the expert visits all states. Think of the expert showing enough recovery motions, right? Even in this setting, behavior cloning still compounds in errors. But the question we are really trying to ask is, can we get away by not having an interactive human expert? I mean, it's a lot of inconvenience for a human to sit and provide labels on when the robot's executing, right? So the question we were asking was, what can we do if instead of an interactive expert, we had an interactive simulator? Can we use that to get an O epsilon T like bound? So this is the setting that we've been thinking about for a while now under a unified framework of distribution matching, which spans work done by Kay, as well as Jonathan. The underlying idea is that we want to use an interactive simulator to build the distribution that the learner visits. So in this setting, think of the expert giving you a bunch of demonstrations and then walking away. But we have access to a simulator that you can use to build the test distribution that the learner induces. So you can actually see where the learner is visiting. And the goal is, can we somehow get these two distributions to match? And if we can do that, maybe we can get a performance guarantee of O epsilon T. So unfortunately, we don't have time to dig into this setting today, but I'll just give you a quick flavor to show you that there's an entire spectrum of algorithms in this medium setting that we call as moment matching algorithms, right? So on the right-hand side of the spectrum, you have what we call matching reward moments. That is, you're trying to find a reward function that discriminates between the learner and the expert trajectory. All inverse reward learning, so Max and IRL, Gale, et cetera, fall into this bucket, including our algorithm ADRIL, which minimizes an IPM metric. The catch is that you need a planning oracle that searches over all actions and so pays for it in exponential of time and computation, right? On the left, you have what we call matching value moments. So you're trying to find a value function that discriminates between a learner and an expert. Our algorithm Alice does this, but does this by adjusting, by using density ratio to counter covariate shift. So it doesn't require a planning oracle, but it requires tons and tons of samples from the simulator to accurately measure the density ratio. The cool thing is that there's a middle ground where you can do both. You can do K steps of planning and then do density weighting for the terminal value. And in some sense, this allows you to balance doing a lot of search versus getting a lot of samples. And yeah, theoretically, the nice thing is all of these algorithms are O epsilon T. So this sort of completes our story for the three regimes of covariate shift, easy, hard, and medium. For the easy setting, don't worry, just go do behavior cloning. For the hard setting, you need an interactive expert and you can use EEL. And for the medium setting, you can get by with an interactive simulator. So finally, I want to show how all of this comes together in the real world in a continuous pipeline of error correction. So step one, we have a real life intervention event where the robot fails to nudge around a car that is jutting out as it's parking. Our operators intervene and drive around the parking vehicle. Step two, we have a human, a triage specialist, that tags this as an intervention event. Step three, we create a simulation of this event where the model runs on policy to see the consequences of incorrect decision making. And as a result, infer the optimal value function. Step four, we update the learned models. And finally, step five, we test this model on the road on complex nudge situations to confirm that it's indeed learned the right behavior. So it's really cool to see some of the methods we just discussed run in practice in the real world and solve problems. But we're not done yet. We're not close to being done yet. There's still many open questions in this regime. For instance, we are looking at just a handful of them. The first question is, can we deal with causal confounds? So causal confounds is very common because, again, as I mentioned before, the human may have access to privileged information that the learner simply doesn't have. So can we expand our imitation learning framework to handle causal confounds? What are good algorithms in the medium setting? Can we theoretically come up with tighter and tighter bounds for algorithms? And finally, we assume that human demonstrations are optimal, but we all know that humans are not optimal. Oftentimes, this is not the case. So how can we outperform the humans under some mild conditions on the reward functions? These are all areas of open research. Okay, so that brings us to an end of challenge one. Let's move on to challenge two, intent prediction. In this challenge, we want to explore the question, how do we interactively forecast human actions when we do planning? So once again, I'll start with a simple example that I really love, mergers. You know, when you first learn driving, this is often a very stressful maneuver. Here we have a robot truck in the right-of-way lane and a car merging in. Now, let's say we have already solved imitation learning. So we've learned a really good cost function from human demonstrations. Now the question is, all we need to do is we need to be able to plan with this cost function. So to do that, we need to do two things. We need to first predict the 5-second future trajectory of the car, and then maybe call a planner to compute an optimal trajectory. So all we really need is a good enough forecast of the other car. How do we get this? Now, industry has been working on this problem for a long time now. The traditional approach is to treat forecasting as a cascaded step after perception and before motion planning. Recent methods have improved upon this by joining perception and forecasting in a differentiable end-to-end manner, but crucially, motion planning is still viewed as a downstream consumer of this forecast. So let's see what happens as a result. So, you know, we go collect a lot of data to train our forecast model. So in our training data, we see 50% of the time the human merges after the car, and 50% of the time the human merges before. We then train our favorite latest greatest forecast model to predict the future. This is what we get. The forecasts look like one huge blob that's spread across the front of the robot. They have a large variance. As a result, the planner is left with no choice looking at this forecast, but to brake heavily. So something horrible happened with our plan. As you might have guessed, the problem is that we're in some ways averaging over two distinct modes in our data. So mode A is the robot merges after the car, so it slows down and lets the car go ahead. And mode B, the robot merges before the car, so it speeds up and the car slows down. And when we try to train one forecast model, it's averaging over these modes. And as a result, the planner freaks out and looking at this average and breaks excessively. So the key observation is that what the robot does depends on what the human's doing, and what humans do depend on the robot, right? And so in some sense, this is the chicken or egg problem of forecasting, right? So to do planning, you need really good forecasts, but to generate forecasts, you need to know what the robot will do. So you need a plan. And so here is another example, a more realistic example of the robot taking an unpredicted left turn at an intersection with vehicles, bicyclists, and pedestrians. And there's a lot going on here, so let me break it down. We see that the robot's actions depend on what other actors in the scene are doing, right? So we need to yield to the vehicle turning right, as well as pedestrians crossing the intersection. Moreover, there's an oncoming car that's waiting on the robot to determine when it can attempt its own unpredicted left. So we see that, you know, let's take this scene and kind of abstract it out. We see that all actors in the scene influence each other, right? The robot is simply the actor in the scene we get to control. So as a result, we need to jointly reason over these actors to produce forecasts and subsequently our plan. But wait, the space of joint trajectory is massive. I mean, think of each trajectory as its own t-dimensional vector of waypoints. And if you have n actors, the space is exponentially large with n. And this still doesn't address our chicken or egg problem. So our key insight is that this continuous space of possibilities is actually misleading. There is an underlying discrete grammar in which we reason, what I like to call modes. It is these discrete modes that make joint reasoning tractable. So what are the modes for self-driving? So we define sort of three fundamental modes which we can use to describe any interaction we see in self-driving, right? And that's if you have two actors, A and B, and if A and B have a conflict and B arrives first, we say A is yielding to B. Otherwise, if A arrives first, we say B is yielding to A. And if there's no conflict, we say that both actors are not yielding to each other. So, using this grammar of modes, you can go ahead and analyze a bunch of instances of self-driving. This is active work in collaboration with McCall at Aurora. So let's work through a particular example just to see what we're talking about. So let's take a merge example. So we have a robot R and two actors A and B. And let's say I tell you this sentence that R yields to A and B yields to R, right? Knowing this, we can forecast all three actors forward. In fact, I can go as far as to say that a mode corresponds to a single basin of forecast. More generally, if we were to write down the value function, which is a function of all three actors, it will be multimodal, but this sentence, this mode, specifies a particular basin of the value function. And this works for more complicated scenes like lane changes. So just skip this, all right. Okay, so let's return back to our problem. We're going to abstract away the scene with a graph. Imagine each actor as a node in the graph. The edges of the graph tell us relationships, like is actor A yielding to actor B? Now, given a set of decisions by the robot, let's say it's yielding to both the pedestrians, we are going to infer decisions made by the other actors with respect to each other by passing messages. For instance, we can infer that the car wants to turn right, but it's yielding to pedestrians. As a result, the robot must yield to the car, which has a right of way. Finally, the oncoming car is turning left and will not yield to the robot. So once we know these modes, we can predict future motions for all actors conditioned on the mode and information from neighbors. And once we have the forecast, we can call the planner to compute a plan. So how do we use machine learning to infer these modes and make these forecasts? So we put all of this intuitions together using a multi-stage graph neural network, which we call geometric transformer net. This is based on some work by Sumit et al. The word transformer here really refers to the aggregation step in the graph neural network. So the input to the GNN are node features, for example, state and history of each actor, and edge features, transforming one actor into another frame. We then encode these features and do K rounds of message passing. And finally, there are two outputs. We predict the discrete mode for each edge, so which actor is yielding to which actor. And based on this, we predict T-step trajectories for each node. So let's look at how interactions play out. We can see that by reasoning about different modes, the robot is able to confidently navigate this complicated intersection. Another interesting fact is you see the cyclist that pops out from behind an oncoming vehicle. The robot must quickly perceive it, incorporate it into its forecast, and create a new plan to execute this turn safely. Let's go back to merges, which is what we started this discussion with. We are negotiating a merge with other actors in the scene and trying to decide how to adjust our speed to find an open slot within a stream of traffic. Once again, we apply this graph neural network and infer the following modes. And based on this interactive reasoning, the robot chooses to slow down, merge behind the first two vehicles while the third vehicle makes room and merges in behind as expected. So the exciting thing here is that this is a production model that is running on the road all the time Every day it gets tested hundreds of miles on the road and millions of miles in simulation. This model is the key for the robot to understand humans on the road, and the more miles it runs, the better it gets. So with that, we are coming to an end. So looking forward, I am excited to start a lab at Cornell. And I'm going to briefly talk about some of the problems that we will be taking on. Now let's go back to the two fundamental challenges that we laid out initially. The first one was, how should robots learn tasks from natural human interactions? So think of grandma unpacking a brand new robot apprentice that has to, you know, pick up tasks she does around the house. You know, there are many, many questions to be answered, but these are just some of the few fundamental questions we're excited to solve. First, what are some flexible task representations that cover the space of tasks and can be learned in a few short way? Second, how do we learn from multimodal feedback like language, vision, or touch? Third, how do we learn under causal confounds, like how much grandma trusts the robot, how she adapts to the robot, et cetera. On to the second challenge. Now that the robot has picked up a task, it must plan to accomplish these tasks alongside human partners. Again, these are some of the questions we need to answer. So we talked about these modes for self-driving. What are these modes for everyday tasks? How do we learn them? The second is, how should a robot plan to communicate its intent or its understanding of others' intent? And third, and most importantly, any robot around close human proximity must be safe and predictable. So I'm really excited to work with my students to take on some of these challenges. And I would like to acknowledge the amazing co-authors and collaborators involved in the work I presented today. Particularly, I would love to like to acknowledge the entire team at Aurora for working tirelessly towards the amazing product we have today. So with that, I would love to take some questions.
Thanks, Sanjiban. I think we're open for questions. I'll go first. Thank you, of course, for the great work. It's always great to hear. I learned something even when you're describing papers that I've written. So thank you for that. I guess one question I had was that there are certain assumptions that we make around the optimality of the planning algorithms that we may have given we hallucinate a cost function, which is sort of an integral part of that loop. And of course, there are some negative results around the fact that like if you're not able to solve the MDP accurately, then in the worst case, very, very bad things can happen. But I guess I have two questions there. One is sort of, what is the pragmatic answer to that? Because clearly, as I was like listening to you talk, I was thinking like, surely you're not solving that planning problem optimally. Like it seems really hard. And then secondly, like, do you feel like there may be directions that we can take towards getting some guarantees on the gap between the true optimal solution and what we're able to plan?
Thanks. That's a really great question. So let me start with the first one. The pragmatic answer is if you're faced with a non-convex problem, there's just no hope of guaranteeing global convergence. I think one of the things we practically try very hard to do is make sure that given a mode, each of the cost functions are as single basement as possible. This doesn't necessarily mean that we are solving, finding the solution to, the optimal solution, but it's getting pretty close, and that's something that we can separately verify. So that's a pragmatic thing, that even though the original problem is non-convex, given a mode, each sub-problem is close to being convex, right? It has a clear solution. I think that's practically what we do to sort of get around this question of, is the planner, has the planner like converge, or should we give it more iterations? Right? And that's something we should build metrics and test separately. The second, I guess, question is, how can we prove guarantees? I mean, one thing, as you were asking the question, I was thinking is that, ultimately, right, all we see is, the cost function and some Bellman operations on the cost function resulting in a T-step trajectory, right? So you know, if you ask the basic question, what would IOC learn if you use a suboptimal planner? Well, it will learn a cost function that kind of compensates for the fact that you're not going to solve it optimally, right? In some sense, and most of the guarantees are in the agnostic setting that like the expert is not realizable, right? So you have an imperfect planner, and so you know the guarantees that you might end up getting is that as long as given your imperfect planner, as long as there exists a cost function in your cost function class, that gets you with an epsilon optimal in terms of matching behavior. That's the best we can hope for. But I haven't seen any work that actually tries to work through this math. It would be an interesting thing to do to see if there are any like catches there, but yeah, that's my first response to that question. Yes.
Cool. Yeah, I have a few more questions, but looks like Celeste has a hand raised. Go ahead, Celeste.
Sanjiban, if we were to imagine the future 20 years from now, and it's not just one Aurora truck, but let's say the whole highway is full of Aurora trucks, or even other companies' trucks, would you think that it would still be the same type of planner, or would it be more aggressive or less aggressive because you're kind of training it just on humans, but how would it interact with other robots? Would it be easier? Do you think there'd be more of a conflict or less?
That's a great question. So I would say that, if I were to make the assumption that through this 20-year journey, we are humans always driving on the road, and all these companies are trying to drive like a human, otherwise it would be a super annoying product. We are all, in some sense, all of these trucks are appearing from the, you know, as far as outside perceptions go, human-like, right? And so when we look at another agent X that is an autonomous truck, but that's imitating humans, it makes sense that all the models that we're building, you know, to infer the intent of humans can apply to those trucks as well. Now, I guess at some point of time, if there's a protocol for communication, I think that would be a bit of a discrete shift in how planning is done. But that's not something I've really thought about. I'm sure others at Aurora have. But I don't think I'm really qualified to answer that. But yeah, I think the trajectory that we would follow as we go through these, you know, more and more autonomous cars is hopefully they're all trying to drive like humans. And so we are kind of proceeding in a very stable way, the models kind of transfer over. But yeah, that's a wishful thinking. Let's see if that pans out. But yeah, thank you for that wonderful question.
Amal?
Yeah, thanks for this great talk. So, one of the things you mentioned was how right now the Aurora truck's on the road, then it's about to do something dangerous. And then someone, presumably the human operator, like, you know, grabs control of the wheel and like gives that intervention, right? So this works great when you have one human per truck, but in terms of thinking about scaling this up, I'm curious to get your thoughts on like, you know, if there's an approach where the robot can know, like, you know, have a low probability of success on its actions in this area, and then like ask a remote human who might now be managing like five different trucks for help. Like, I'm curious to get your thoughts on approaches in that direction.
Yeah, that's a great question. And that's sort of along the lines of things that we've been doing. The TeleAssist program at Aurora is actually going along these lines. The general idea is pretty much very close to what you described, which is if the truck is detecting an anomalous situation, it sort of proactively queries the human and then sort of does an evasive maneuver to come slowly to a stop and ask the human. For example, it sees some weird construction that it's never seen before, or something anomalous happens on the road. I haven't actively worked on this, so this is sort of my perspective of it. But yeah, I would say that anomaly detection is an incredibly challenging problem, especially in high dimensional state space. And I think, you know, there's simple things we can do to deal with a broad set of cases. But I think I always think of if there is a module that's smart enough to know, hey, I'm in a anomalous state that I've not seen before. I'm in a state where I think I'm going to do bad things. Mathematically, you can think of that as being pretty good estimator of your value function, like knowing that all the actions you're about to take is going to be pretty bad. And I would say that agent has to be as smart as the planner, right? And so those are some thoughts. I feel like it is not an easy, it's as hard as, at least in the same order of hardness as solving the planning problem, detecting this anomaly. So that's something that, we probably need a good story around. But yeah, that's a good question. Thank you.
Just as a follow-up, I guess, like I was thinking naively, one can have a meta MVP, one of whose actions is to ask for help. I was thinking of ways in which you might cost that meta MVP so that you can learn to ask for help. And of course, exactly like you said, if there is no cost to it, then it'll just ask for help all the time. And then the question is then of like, how do you trade off asking for help versus not? But that seems like it's certainly interesting.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
I had one more question that was a follow-up from the previous question, which is that oftentimes we have planning problems that are intractable. Let's take like multi-agent planning. You're trying to plan for multiple interacting agents, and that, as you know, you're planning in the cross-product space and blows up pretty fast. And of course, the way we try to address that is to come up with like limited horizon or various other reductions, the worst of which being like all agents plan greedily and then you replan whenever there's congestion. I guess the question for you is that like, and this is pure blue sky speculation that's probably utter random, is that like, is there a way to transform that problem into an imitation learning problem where you're learning a cost in a different space that allows each of these agents to act either independently or in small groups that tries to mimic what the solution to the full problem might look like?
Yeah, that's pretty spot on. In fact, I would say that your question is almost, very similar to the approach we're taking. Like if you think of, even if you're just controlling one agent, right? And you have other humans in the scene, you still need to have this flavor of multi-agent planning where you're forecasting, which you can think of that as planning as well. And just to repeat what you said, yes, it is an extremely hard problem. It scales exponentially in the number of actors, but if this is sort of a collaborative, if we know that this is a collaborative game, right? We know that there are equilibrias of this game that probably these agents are trying to hit. All we really need to do is to, reason about what equilibria that we should try to follow, right? Like when we're merging what slot, you think of each slot as an equilibria that we should try to follow. And given an equilibria, I think that part is clear that we can, define a very, convex optimization that each agent can solve because they know the equilibria that all the other agents are following. Now, the key question is, in a decentralized setting, how do the agents agree upon the equilibria? How do they communicate it? And I think, I think some of the legibility stuff that, obviously you've done and others have been doing, I think Zach Manchester also has some pretty interesting papers worth checking out. Get at this problem of how do you communicate essentially what equilibria you're choosing? And then once the entropy about that has collapsed, I think you're good to go. This is something very interesting today, I think, I don't have the best story around, but something that I'm thinking a lot about.
Thank you. I actually have one more question. I'm just going to keep asking questions unless it's a unique opportunity to grill Sanjiban in front of an audience. I had a question about the interactive imitation learning work. I must also admit I'm a co-author on that paper, so it's a question as much for me as it is for Sanjiban. Yeah. Which is that, like, I guess a lot of the interaction depends on what you start off with. Like, if you start off with something that's mildly reasonable, then it requires far fewer interventions and interactions and corrections to solve the problem. But if you start off with something that's like truly garbage, then it might be actually very, very challenging to interactively correct that. Yeah. And so this brings me to both a theoretical and a practical question. Like one theoretical question is, like, can we predict the number of interactions that are needed? And if you think of interaction as a cost, like you had mentioned on the user, can we then, the practical question is, if that interaction needed is too much, can we just say like, you know what? This is just not worth it. Like, let's just go back to the drawing board and get a better initial policy.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, it's a great question. So I would say that the way I like to think about this is, if you think of it from the, you know, online learning setting, right? Like you're starting off with a garbage policy, as you put it. Let's call that, say, pi. And this pi star, that's, if you were to get to pi star, no human wouldn't intervene. Let's say you're really, really far off from pi and pi star, right? So, I mean, almost all online learning proofs look like either you got it right and, you know, the human didn't intervene and you did the right thing, so you incurred almost no regret for that round, or you did something wrong and the human intervened and you incurred some regret, right? And so really this, I think the mathematical trick that we used in the paper and been using since is to transfer all of this, you know, to transfer these act of interventions is essentially, you know, how much regret an algorithm can eat up. And as long as you have a regret bound, which we can now borrow because it's a reduction to online learning, if we can come with no regret algorithms, we know this regret's bounded, so we can go bound the number of feedback. So that's like the trick we use to turn bounds onto regret to bounds on amount of intervention. And so, yeah, and I think to answer your question, if you start with the garbage policy, hey, you're gonna have a lot of regret, you know, which scales with your distance from the two policies. I think you can kind of get some upper bounds on that based on that initial distance between the two. So, yeah, I don't know if that answered your question, but that's how I would think about it.
Oh, yeah, thanks. Yeah, I think it's worthwhile. Yeah, it was just mulling over a practical algorithm that we might come up with. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah.
I know we're at time. So thank you so much, Sanjiban, for the wonderful talk. And it was a pleasure chatting and talk to you again very soon.
Yeah, it's great to see you all. Hope to see you all soon. Take care. Thank you again. Bye-bye.